Be nice.
Nope, I'm not gonna
be nice to me.
I was nice the first time. That's me.
Oh,
you
geez.
Didn't record it, so now that's what
happened. Okay, I messed up. Hey, welcome to Decaf, a podcast by the Beacon Center of Tennessee. I'm Taylor. This is Mark. We're back from Thanksgiving.
For the second time.
We
just recorded, but Taylor.
We recorded. Okay, I messed up. The record button wasn't pushed. It's fine. Everything's fine. It's pushed now.
The record button wasn't pushed. It's like you're blaming on the button. Taylor did not push the record button, so we are doing it again.
Listen, okay, I've had one cup of coffee today. My brain's moving a little slower than normal. Okay, honestly, one insult. Let's keep our insult count again. Mark spent Thanksgiving in New York.
I went
and had Thanksgiving meal with my family, had a few glasses of wine, fell asleep in the recliner, and then drove home. So, you know, to each his own.
After you slept enough that you were good to drive home.
Well, yeah.
You don't want to say a few glasses of wine, then drove home. So, yes, she slept it off.
Took a long turkey-induced nap, and then I drove home. So, good Thanksgiving was had all around,
absolutely.
I would say.
Absolutely, yep.
So to get into our first topic, someone who I guess didn't have a good Thanksgiving is Kamala Harris.
Yep.
Your girl is out of the race.
Not my girl, don't say.
Okay, just generally speaking, your girl.
Someone's girl.
Someone's girl has dropped out of the race, which is a shocking turn of events to me. I did not see that coming.
Yeah, it's not shocking based on the last week or two, but it's shocking based on where we're at 2 months ago where she looked like a potential front runner.
I mean, yeah, and so let's talk about spending. So one of the interesting things that I was looking at in terms of her, of all of the candidates that have dropped out of the race so far, she has, by a long shot, by over $10 million, spent more than these candidates. So she has spent $25 million, and the second runner-up on spending was Kirsten Gillibrand at $14 million. I mean, she spent a lot. She was actually in the top five of the highest spenders of all of the people who are running on the Democratic side. It was Sanders, Warren, Buttigieg.
Mayor Pete's easier,
Mayor
but Buttigieg.
Biden, and then Harris.
Yeah.
And now she's out.
Well, what's interesting is why she's out. Because we talked about, she obviously spent the money to be in. She had that big debate moment against Biden where she really rose to the top.
She really did. People were calling her out. And now she's... she's gone.
But
I'm shocked.
The number one issue for almost every voter, and it doesn't really matter where you stand, is healthcare. Healthcare is such a
big issue.
And she has not had a consistent stand on it.
No.
She said, oh, let's take away private insurance. She said, oh, wait, maybe not. People don't like that.
Yeah.
And she kind of put together a plan of kind of weirdly taking everything that polls high and put into one plan. Everyone's like, that doesn't make any sense.
No.
Even the Democrats, like the people on both sides who are like for Medicare for all and the people who are against it are like, yeah, her plan's terrible. She doesn't really have a plan.
Well, you know, she kind of drives me insane. I haven't been quiet about it, but I just feel like when you're not principled, you can just flip around like that and it doesn't mean anything to you.
It was like she took the best talking points and put them all together in a plan, and it wasn't really
a plan.
And
that's not a thing. You can't do that.
Say what you want about Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders, and obviously we disagree with their plan, but at least they've been consistent on it. They've had a stance.
I feel like consistency is so important.
And they've not gone against it. So I think that people don't know where she stands on issues, and it feels like she flip-flops based on public opinion. And I think that's why she couldn't gain, because she gained traction, but then lost it. And
so,
it's not because of lack of money spent, obviously.
Exactly. And I honestly liked her branding. I thought it was really cool looking. So where are her votes going to go?
Well, I think we disagree. I'd say Mayor Pete is the most likely. He seems to be rising, young guy, just like she was young, well-spoken. I think that they have a lot in common in that.
Okay, so I think, based on the flack that I caught for not supporting Hillary last time, is as a woman, the woman votes are going to go to someone like Elizabeth Warren.
Or Klobuchar. I mean, she's actually probably closer to Klobuchar if you actually look at their policies.
Yeah, I don't know.
But Warren's sinking. I mean, she's kind of a sinking ship right now. I don't know if that's...
But maybe more women votes will go to her. I don't know. All I know is based on my...
Yeah, really.
All I know is based on my personal experience.
But again, if you want to talk about Kamala Harris 2 months ago, she had 20% of the vote. Where did that go?
Where's that going to go? Speaking of spending a whole lot of money, happy Black Friday being over.
happy Black Friday being over. It's a new holiday.
I guess. Seriously. Happy time to get our bank accounts back in order.
Yes.
So Black Friday is kind of a great thing and kind of the bane of my existence. I was once at Walmart on Black Friday.
Oh, gosh.
I was buying a television, and I was in line, and the woman handed me a voucher to get this television for 50% off, and it was the last one, and this other woman looked me in the eyes, snatched it out of my hands, and ran away. So
wow.
I do not shop in-store on Black Friday. I went to one store on Black Friday, Lemon Lane here in Nashville. Shout out to you guys. They're the best. Mm-hmm. Every other shopping thing that I did was online, and a lot of Americans also did the same thing. For the first time ever, Black Friday online shopping surpassed Cyber Monday.
Okay, that's interesting.
Yes, $190 million were spent between Thursday and Monday of this year. And
now, was more money spent on Black Friday online or in person? I bet online.
No, it was in person. It was 140 something million in person.
Oh, okay. See, what's weird is who are the people who wait outside to say, oh, I'm saving $90 on this TV. I don't have to wait out in the cold for 10 hours. Like, is your time really not worth more than $9 an hour in the freezing cold?
Seriously, I sat on my couch and I watched Disney Plus and I sipped hot coffee and I did online shopping. Yeah. And that's kind of the way it's done, everyone. That's how the way you do it. So one thing I definitely thought was interesting, though, is say what you want about the administration, the direction, the country, whatever. Spending this Black Friday through, or I guess Thanksgiving Day through Cyber Monday, was up 14% from last year. People are not anxious to spend money anymore.
No. They feel like they're doing well, and they feel like they have a little extra money. Because, again, 14% for things that are clearly non-essential is a big deal.
I mean, some of the things might be labeled as more necessary than others. I know that I had a lot of friends who waited to buy a vacuum cleaner or a microwave or, like, home things, not pillows and sweaters, like stuff that I bought. But mostly non-essential things that people bought. It was up for spending, not just, you know, not just Black Friday was up this much or whatever. Spending in general was up 14%.
And really, spending on things that you don't need is the biggest indicator of the economy doing well. And
plenty of discretionary income for Americans to spend.
That's right. And even the Democrats who are running for president have to say not everyone's doing well, because they can't say the economy's not good. Obviously, the economy's good. They're just saying there is people being left behind, which, I mean, is true to some extent.
That's kind of how it is sometimes, though.
But I mean, it is true. But the idea is you can't say the economy's bad. Like, maybe some people are being left behind, but most people have more money now than they did at this point last year.
We want is success. We don't want people left behind. We don't. Yeah. We want everyone to be successful, but
or at least have the opportunity to be successful.
And we're kind of getting there. I would think everyone, but this is a big indicator of that we're getting
things
there.
Are at least going in the right direction. For
absolutely,
sure.
Definitely. Yeah. Another thing that is going in the right direction is Memphis football.
Ooh,
now
that's a really
that
good,
was a great transition. Smooth.
Way better than the Black Friday or Thanksgiving. Kamala Harris one.
So true. But I mean, my transitions are kind of on point right now. I'm going to jinx myself the last topic. Yeah. So I will qualify this by saying I have a friend in Memphis who we were talking about the podcast the other day, and she said that we are an equal opportunity offender. Nothing is safe. No one is safe as far as podcast topics go, or really anything that we talk about.
Yeah.
And
Memphis is certainly not
Memphis, we've really given Memphis a lot of flack this year about Bluff City Law, about corporate welfare deals, about ServiceMaster moving, just
IKEA,
yeah, all the things. But there is something kind of magical going on in Memphis right now.
Memphis Magic.
What's up? I love football, and the Memphis Tigers are really taking off right now.
They are. They're I think they're 11-1 now, and they just beat Cincinnati, and they're playing for essentially a chance to go to a New Year's Six game against one of the big boys.
That's awesome.
Which is a really, really big deal. Memphis had College Game Day this year.
That's so great.
Their last game was against Cincinnati. It was on ESPN. I mean, they are really taking off, and they are for sure the best team in our state right now.
That not hard to be. Take that, Vols. Yeah. But I remember, you know, the beginning of the season when we were talking about college football and Memphis had beaten Ole Miss that week. And, you know, Ole Miss isn't great, but they are an SEC team. And
that just fired their coach.
Wah, wah. But for Memphis to really, I've been a college football fan pretty much my whole life, and they've never kind of come across my radar until now.
Yeah, they've had a couple decent years, 9-3 and 4 years. But this is a chance, and if they were to beat Cincinnati this set, because they're doing a rematch with them for the AAC conference,
which is kind of stressful, because every time Alabama has done a rematch, playing someone regular season, then playing the conference championship, the winner usually flips.
Yeah, well, I mean, hopefully this week that's not the case. But what will be interesting is to see them on this national stage. They were already against SMU on College Game Day, but if they can really play tough, even if they don't win with one of these Power Five teams, if they get like a Michigan or an Auburn or Notre Dame, and be able to play tough with them, that would be a really big deal.
A lot of exposure for the program.
And again, Memphis is a big school, and they're really coming up in both sports. I mean, they're a top 15 team in basketball. They had a great recruiting class. I mean, Memphis could be one of the next premier programs who could end up potentially joining one of these big conferences if they keep
winning.
That
would be really awesome. Good for them. I mean, I know their coach, you've said
that Mike Norvell, he's likely going to Florida State,
Or
Ole Miss. Ole Miss is the other choice.
Well,
so you might see him in the SEC next year.
That would be really cool. Good for him.
Hopefully he stays, though. It'd be cool to see him
It would be cool to see him build the program. That would be really awesome.
It's been two really good years in a row, so Coach Norvell, Beacon wants you to stay.
Yes, we want you to stay. I hope that Memphis plays Auburn so that I can cheer for someone that I like against Auburn, because generally speaking, I cheer for anyone against Auburn.
So it'd be fun to cheer
for. But it would be cheer for someone that I actually like. Yeah, that'd be awesome.
We're hoping for a Memphis versus Auburn.
Yeah, Memphis versus Auburn. Go Memphis Tigers, not Auburn Tigers, ever, ever, ever. So
I'm
salty. Okay, I'm salty. I don't want to talk about Alabama football. I don't want to talk about the Iron Bowl. But the last thing I do want to talk about is something that Mark and I actually agree on this, and I didn't know if we would. But Justin sent us an article recently about it's from the Wall Street Journal, and it was about studies of how people have departed from their usual brands that they support because of the brand's political affiliations and their political leanings. And it was called "Are Your Jeans Red or Blue?" And it was talking about the blue jean business and how Levi's, based in San Francisco, has erred on the side of taking up more Democratic policies, and Wrangler is kind of still the jeans of middle America. They
Brett
haven't,
Favre.
They have not spoken out, and their leadership has said, we're really not going to take political stances. And so the red, I guess you could say, has stuck with Wranglers more than they have with Levi's. And, you know, I went through a phase where I would say, well, this corporation doesn't support things that I support, or they support things that I blatantly do not support. And I'm not going to buy from them anymore. But I'm kind of at a place in my life now where if Levi's makes good jeans, I pretty much exclusively wear Levi's jeans. I'm going to keep wearing them.
Because I mean, it's a good product and you believe in capitalism. And
yeah, absolutely.
I mean, I went to a conference and I had Lyft, which is the competitor to Uber, speak. And they are very liberal on it. But they're usually cheaper, and I think they're usually a better service.
So I
do agree. Some stuff they believe in, but mostly I don't agree with them. But it's a better service, and I like them better than Uber. So I'm going to keep using that.
Exactly. You know, there was a lot of hubbub about Colin Kaepernick and his Nike ads, and people were burning their Nike clothes. I really like my Nike shoes.
See, I don't like Nike that much. So
okay, I really like Nike, and I was kind of like, well, you know, I think that was the first time that I was at a place where a lot of people were speaking out on that, and I was like, I'm just going to keep wearing my Nike stuff to spin, and that's just kind of what it is.
And Fila is the better version of Nike.
I love my Fila.
Yeah, I know. Fila's like, it's cheaper, it's retro. I mean, Nike's fine, but go for Fila.
I agree.
If you want to boycott it, go for Fila.
I wonder where Fila is on the political spectrum.
I bet nobody cares.
They haven't said anything in a long time.
Yeah.
You know, and one of the things is, I feel like we can go as far as to say we don't care what they support. Now, if someone's supporting like a terrorist organization, I'm going to really draw the line there.
Even if somebody really supports like stone cold socialism,
I'm out.
Like Lyft is like, they might support social programs, stuff that I might not completely agree with.
But like straight up Bernie Sanders socialism, I'm out on that.
Yeah. I mean, even Bernie Sanders is not really a socialist compared to what real socialism is.
Like Venezuela socialism.
He's getting there, but he's not there.
He's awfully close.
Yeah, Ben & Jerry's might be the closest brand that I would not support, because they are very socialist. Oh yeah, they're like the most left brand there is.
Wow.
I don't think my dad eats them because of that. I'm not there yet, but I don't really eat ice cream that much. But I feel like that's one that maybe someday I would. But for now, as long as they still believe in kind of capitalism, I'll support them.
Well, anyone who's straight up capitalism, I'm here for you. We want to hear from you guys. What do you think? Do you support brands who don't support your ideology, or do you support brands who go against your ideology?
And now Chick-fil-A meets both. So
and now Chick-fil-A is either way.
I mean, love it no matter what.
Chick-fil-A will always have a place in my heart. I will always eat Chick-fil-A. But what do y'all think? Send us a message on Facebook, comment on this, Instagram, Twitter, shoot me an email, taylor@beacontn.org. I want to hear what you guys think about these partnerships of brands and their political beliefs, and even candidates and outspoken advocates for certain things. And we'll talk about some of those on the show next week.
Sounds good.
Yeah. All right. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time.